Well, thank you for turning up on this session. To be absolutely clear, this is going to be a web session. It's not going to be about native iOS or Android. Although I think that there will be a few lessons that you can draw if you're a native developer. What I'm going to talk about today is viewports. Who here has heard of viewports? Okay, that's good. Don't worry, I'm going to explain everything, including the gory details you don't really want to know. So, my name is Peter Paul Koch, PPK. I'm from Amsterdam. I run a site called quirksmode.org, where I test browsers so you don't have to. And I'm a specialist on a few very specific parts of web development, one of which is viewports. And I'm going to talk about that today. What you will also learn today is why responsive design works, not how. I mean, you've all created a responsive site, right? Okay, please raise your hand if you have ever created a responsive site. Oh, not everybody. Okay, interesting. But in any case, you probably know how to create a responsive site, but why does it work? That's what I'm going to treat today. Also, I created something for you, and the irony of the fact is that I'm mostly going to talk about mobile today, but this doesn't actually work on mobile, so if any one of you have a laptop with you, I advise you to open this URL, quirkmode.org/mobile/viewports. It contains a little app I created in order to explain basically what I'm talking about, because the theory is quite dense, but once you see it on the screen, say, oh, that's what he's talking about, no problem here. So I advise you to just load this, play with it, and I will refer to it a few times during my presentation. So we are going to talk about viewports today. But in order to talk about viewports, I first have to briefly talk about pixels, because a pixel is not a pixel. That is, there are two different kinds of pixels on the web. And in general, that's not much of a problem for web developers, but it's good to be very explicit about this sort of thing, because we're going to go deep into the theory. So, there are CSS pixels and device pixels. Now, what does that mean? First of all, you probably already know what it means, but you don't realize it. So don't worry too much. But I still have to treat them officially. So let's start with CSS pixels, which are by far the most important ones. They are basically what we use in our CSS. If you say width 190 pixels or padding left 20 pixels, you are using CSS pixels. And they are essentially an abstract construct created specifically for us web developers. They are essentially a way of abstracting away the screen of the device you happen to work on. And that may sound very theoretical. I will show you what I mean in a little while. The point about CSS pixels is that they can become larger or smaller when the user zooms in or out. And that is something not many people realize, but I will give a practical example of this. This is a very old site of a conference I used to run. And, of course, this site was about the mobile web, so it has a proper responsive design. But for most of this presentation, we're going to pretend that it is not responsively designed, that it's just an old-fashioned desktop site. I should also warn you that the first part of this presentation is quite old, so you will see a lot of references to ancient phones. But that's okay, because I'm trying to make a general point, and you know, you can go down memory lane and say, oh yes, I remember the times when I had that phone, and so on, and so on. It's fun. Anyway, this site, Mobilism, has a menu over here, and that menu has a width of 190 pixels. That was just hard-coded into the CSS. Our designer decided it should be 190 pixels, so we put that in the CSS. This is not remarkable. Now we are going to zoom in this site a little bit. This is just a desktop site, so this is what happens, completely as expected. But the point I want to make here is that this menu is still 190 pixels wide, even though you will see that it's now wider. What happens here, the CSS pixels themselves become larger because I zoomed in. Okay. Let's briefly talk about the device pixels. I will get back to zooming later, by the way. Device pixels are simply the physical pixels on your screen. Every single computing device that has a screen also has physical hardware device pixels. You know, that glow up red, green, or blue, or a combination of that, or white, or black, or whatever, and show the color on the screen. These are hardware, so you cannot change them in any way. They're also not all that important to web developers. And there's a fixed amount of them that depends on the device. But the funny thing is, you don't really need to know about that, except when you treat Retina devices or similar devices differently than other devices. But I'm not going to go into that because this presentation is long enough as it is. Here's the first old phone. Who remembers this phone? It's an iPhone 3G. It was the first iPhone I personally owned, so it has some kind of... It's a thing for me. In any case, the point I want to make here is that this old iPhone 3G had a device pixel of 320. That is, there were 320 device pixels in a row from left to right. Now, with the iPhone 4S, I think that changed. No, sorry. I'm first going to explain something else. Because what we're seeing here is that a CSS pixel, if you do not zoom in, exactly matches one device pixel. Right, one device pixel equals one CSS pixel if you do not zoom in. All that changed with the iPhone 4S because they suddenly had twice as many device pixels. That was the whole Retina screen thing, right? The Retina screen was basically, okay, we put in twice as many device pixels. But, and that's the important part, the ideal screen width, the ideal layout viewport, I will talk about that later, remained at 320. So what we get here is that one CSS pixel now spans four device pixels, 2x2, right? And then here you're starting to see why CSS pixels are an abstract construct. If you don't know anything about Retina screens, if you don't know anything about screen sizes, you can still just create a website that looks fine because you are using CSS pixels, and the device and the browser magically make sure that your CSS pixels match device pixels as they should, and so on and so on. It's something you do not have to worry about in general. So I basically answered the next question already. What kind of pixels do you use in your daily work? CSS pixels, almost always. There's one exception, and that exception is screen.width. And screen.width is a serious problem that we are going to get back to later in this session. But other than that, you're always using CSS pixels. Width, 120 pixels, means 120 CSS pixels. If you use ms or centimeters, or any other unit, they are recalculated into pixels, which are CSS pixels. So don't worry too much about that part. Okay, now that we know about the two types of pixels, we can go into the actual viewports. And I first want to give another example of the mobilism side. We here have a left bar that has a width of 34%, because the designer decided that should be the width. Now I'm going to teach you a little trick. Whenever you encounter a percentage in CSS or in JavaScript, always ask yourself, percentage of what? This says 34%. 34% of what? We all know the answer, 34% of the screen width, right? That's obvious. But let's dig a little deeper into what's actually going on here, because it will be instructive and you need that knowledge in order to understand the rest of my presentation. So, officially, in CSS, if you give a width in percentages, that width is calculated relative to the width of the containing element. And in the case of the sidebar we saw just now, the containing element is the body. So what we're technically saying is, please give this sidebar 34% of the width of the body. Which leads to the question, what's the width of the body, right? Because we need to know in order to calculate it. Here comes a general CSS rule. Every block level element, including HTML and body, have a default width of 100%. Unless, of course, you specify it otherwise in your CSS. But if you don't specify a width, each block level element has a width of 100%. Sounds great, but the question is, 100% of what? Now, when we come to the body, it's easy, because the body is contained in the HTML element, right? And the HTML, so the 34%, of the body width of 100% is again calculated relative to the HTML element. So we just go up the dump tree, right? We have 34% for the sidebar of the body width, which is 100% of the width of the HTML. What is the width of the HTML? This is again 100%. 100% of what? There is no HTML element above the HTML element itself, right? That's where the document ends. So here, the browser vendors created the viewport. The viewport is basically what says, okay, dear CSS, you have this much room for your layout. The viewport is also called the initial containing block in the CSS specifications. And the basic idea of the viewport is that CSS needs to know how much space it has, right? It's that simple. Can I take 1,000 pixels or 2,000 pixels or 200 pixels or whatever? The initial containing block tells you that. And the initial containing block is the viewport. And on desktop, the viewport is equal to the window width. That is why that 34% you saw at first is 34% of the window width. Now, this all sounds very theoretical, but on mobile, it's much more complicated. And basically, the reason it's much more complicated is because of the small screen size. One more thing about the desktop before we go to mobile. When you zoom in with Control or Command X plus, the CSS pixels become larger, and therefore your viewport becomes smaller. And that is something you also need to realize. And also because as a result of the zooming, fewer CSS pixels fit on the screen. We see again our site. It currently has a viewport of about 720 pixels. That's because of the way I took this screenshot. And it's now normal. Now we're going to zoom in again. And we get this well-known effect, but the viewport is now about 580 pixels. That is because each individual CSS pixel becomes larger, and therefore fewer fit in the window. Okay, that is basically one type of zooming. The other type of zooming is much more complicated. So, let's go to mobile. And before I'm actually going to explain how viewports work on mobile, I first want to present to you the problem that we had 10 years ago. Back 10 years ago, the original iPhone came out, and one of the things that Apple wanted with the original iPhone was, hey, you are now able to surf the web on your mobile phone. There were browsers before the iPhone. The Nokia and BlackBerry browser are older, and there's a bunch of others that nobody but me has ever heard of. But they were not really good. The whole premise of Apple saying, okay, you can now surf the web on your phone, meant that a website had to look well on the mobile phone. And remember, back in 2007, nobody was yet creating mobile-specific or mobile-optimized websites. You only had desktop sites, because nobody had ever heard of mobile. So the challenge to Apple was, okay, we have a desktop website, which is designed for, let's make it 1,000 pixels, and we now have to show that well on a mobile phone. That is the reason that the viewport was split up. We take again our example site, 34% width here. Oh, I already, and 190 pixels here. And now we are going to pretend that a mobile browser works exactly like a desktop browser, and we get this. This is horrible. This is what Apple wanted to avoid. If on a mobile phone you would also say, okay, the viewport is as wide as the browser window, we get this kind of horrible sites. And that's why they changed the definition of the viewport on mobile devices. So what did they do exactly? They said that by default on a mobile device, the viewport would be about 768 to 1024 pixels wide, depending on the device. They had slightly different defaults. Doesn't matter. 980 pixels is the most common one. Why? Because iPhone. The iPhone said, okay, I'm going to make it 980. Again, this is a value for a site that has not been mobile optimized in any way. This is just a plain desktop site, but back in the day, back 10 years ago, people had to be able to view those sites properly on an iPhone. And the only way of doing that was saying, okay, you still have about 1,000 pixels for your CSS layout. This construct is called the layout viewport because it gives the CSS instructions about the layout. It's the initial containing block of the site. It just says, okay, dear CSS, you have this much space for your layout. So if we get a width of 34%, we know to calculate it relative to the 980 pixels or whatever. Responsive design is the art of overriding the default width of the layout viewport. I will get back to that. Okay, so here's an image. This is basically what they did. We have a website that looks perfectly normal and reasonable because the layout viewport is as wide as it would be on a desktop computer. So this site looks well. The only problem, of course, you're already seeing it, is it doesn't fit into the mobile screen. So that's why we need a separate viewport for the actual window width, for the stuff that the user is currently seeing, because that's also interesting information for us web developers, right? And that's called the visual viewport. And that's this. So again, the layout viewport is this, and it's meant in order to give the CSS a baseline for creating a layout. It just says, okay, you have this much space for your CSS. And the visual viewport is usually much smaller and is basically what is the user currently seeing of your site. Of course, you can change the visual viewport size by zooming in and out, right? And you can move it around. Another way of looking at this is the layout viewport is the canvas on which you are creating a beautiful painting, your website. And then on mobile, the visual viewport is the keyhole through which you look at that canvas. And of course, you can move the keyhole, and you can make it larger and smaller, and you can do all kinds of stuff. But it's not ideal. This is the best thing you can do on a mobile device for sites that are not mobile optimized. And this is what they had to do back way in the beginning, right? Back in 2007, no website was mobile optimized, almost no website. So the iPhone had to do this trick in order to make it possible for people to surf the web on a mobile phone. And this has basically continued until today. It still works the same way today, except that, of course, we web developers now know that we have to create a mobile website. And how do we do that? That's what I'm going to talk about next. So, by default, the layout viewport is 768 to 1024, mostly 980. And we call that the default layout viewport. And it's exactly what it says. If you, as a web developer, do not give any instructions whatsoever, this will be the layout viewport. But for a proper mobile experience, the default layout viewport is not good enough. We need to be able to squeeze the site into the mobile screen, right? That's what we want from a mobile site. And that is the job of the ideal layout viewport. The ideal layout viewport is nothing more than two numbers, a width and a height, stored somewhere in the browser memory. And it says, okay, if you want to make your website proper mobile compatible, then you should use this as the dimensions of your layout viewport. You should restrict your CSS like this, and then it will look fine in the mobile browser, as we're seeing here. This is what we want, right? This is a responsive design. What we do here is say, okay, we make an explicit, we give the browser an explicit order to change the viewport. Why don't we do that automatically? Because we web developer have to say, okay, I want you to do this now because I'm prepared for it. I have also prepared a mobile view of this website. It's just a trick in order to force web developers to do something explicitly and think about what they're doing. Who knows which device this is? Well, it's a BlackBerry, obviously, but which one? Does anybody know? No, it's a BlackBerry Z10. I mean, this is completely useless information. You do not need to remember this. The reason I'm still using this old phone here is, first, I have fond memories of it myself, and secondly, it has a slightly weird ideal viewport of 342 by 570. Why 342 by 570, you will ask? Because that's the ideal size for the device it runs on. Right? There is no wrong dimensions for the ideal layout viewport. I have never found a device that did something weird here. It's just that, especially when you work only on the iPhone, you get used to certain sizes. But not all phones are created the same. Every phone vendor thinks about this and says, okay, this should be the ideal layout viewport for my particular device. But there are still weird values. You will occasionally find them, like in the BlackBerry Z10. Apple itself started to change its ideal layout viewport, and that was an excellent idea, because before, and I'm now talking about 6 or 7 years back, everybody was concentrating on the 320 pixels of the iPhone. Oh, there's also a device that does 360 pixels. Oh, I did not know that, and my design doesn't work properly. Oh, no, I never tested on an Android. You know, always test on an iPhone and at least one Android, and preferably more. But I didn't do that until, all of a sudden, Apple said, yeah, but this one has an ideal layout viewport of 375, and this one of 414. And then web developers started to panic for a short while and said, okay, so it's apparently possible that there are several values for this. Well, it has always been possible. It has always been the case, but people don't pay attention. Story of the web's life. Okay, so I now hope that you understand why the desktop viewport, on desktop there's only one viewport, has been split up into a layout and a visual viewport. By the way, I will get back to the ideal viewport later. There's a fun game you should play. Does anybody here ever read a W3C spec? Nobody. Ah, a few. Oh, thank God. You have to read a W3C spec from time to time. You will not understand it, but it's more like, you know, a mystical mantra that you have to mumble every once in a while just to figure out, you know, I know what I'm doing. The fun trick is, if you see viewport in a W3C document, or basically anywhere, always ask yourself, which viewport? The problem is that even though this whole system of two viewports is now 10 years old, they have never officially been specified. There is still no official specification for the layout and the visual viewports. It's all de facto standardization by the browser vendors themselves, helped a little bit by me in the early days. There is, however, a third construct, and that is the document. It's not terribly important, but you still have to know about this. This is an excellent way, time to return to the visualization app I gave you just now. So you can just, and if you have a laptop and your neighbors don't, be nice to them and show it to them, because it really helps your understanding of what I'm talking about. What you can do, you press Z to zoom in this. The blue border thing is the visual viewport. The yellow border thing is the layout viewport. And this thing as a whole is the document, right? And here you see what's going on their mobile device. You basically see whatever is inside the visual viewport, and you can scroll it. You use the arrow keys here. You can scroll it, and you can zoom it, and so on, and so on. The point here is that not only does the visual viewport move, right? That's understandable, because, you know, that's the whole point of the visual viewport, but the layout viewport also moves. When you scroll down far enough in the visual viewport, the layout viewport also starts to move. And this is tricky to wrap your head around, but it is really the case in all modern browsers. It's not a terribly important fact. Most of the time you can get away with not knowing this, except when you use position fixed. Who here has used position fixed on mobile and got something they did not expect? Yes, one person over there. You know what I'm talking about. So the visual viewport moves inside the layout viewport. The layout viewport may also move inside the document. And in the case of position fixed, that's important. What exactly does position fixed do? This is the definition from the W3C spec. For a fixed position box, the containing block, which basically is its reference, is established by the viewport. Which viewport? They don't tell us, because it's never been officially specified. Officially, the layout and visual viewport don't exist. This is great. Spoiler alert, nowadays browsers have standardized on the layout viewport. But in the early days, they tried all kinds of stuff, because when you start thinking about this whole thing, right, if you have a fixed layer on your screen, the whole idea of the fixed layer is that it stays on screen no matter how you scroll, right? That's the idea behind the fixed layer. So on mobile, it would make sense if the fixed layer was placed relative to the visual viewport, so that you always keep it in sight. And in fact, some earlier browsers did so. The problem is that the average web developer who uses a position fixed doesn't know about mobile and makes the fixed layer far too large so that it goes off the side of the mobile screen. And because it's fixed, you can't scroll. You will never see what's in the right half of your fixed layer. And that is why browser vendors eventually said, okay, we're going to forget about the visual viewport. We're going to do it relative to the layout viewport instead. Again, this is not officially specified, because W3C officially does not recognize the fact that there are layout and visual viewports. Okay, so briefly, position. You can also see that in the app, by the way. Position absolute is relative to the document, and it has always been that way, and it's totally what we would expect both on desktop and on mobile. Position fixed means that it's positioned relative to the layout viewports nowadays. You will also see that in the app. But we still would like to have something to position a layer relative to the visual viewport. In some mobile web applications, it would make sense to have a tiny, tasteful toolbar with a few vital buttons, right, that always stays in sight no matter how you scroll. Right now, that's not really something you can do. Well, you can write a script for it that repositions a layer constantly, but that's very ugly, and I would advise against it. Years ago, I proposed a new value for position device fixed. You will also see that in the app. There is a fake position device fixed layer. And no matter how you scroll or zoom, it always stays on the right on the same position in your screen. So far, only IE Edge have implemented it. Nobody else, again, because it's not a part of the official W3C specification. And because Google always thinks it knows better, which it does not in this particular case. So if you want to position something relative to the visual viewport, I'm sorry, but you're out of luck. Well, you can use device fixed, but it only works in Edge, and Edge is not the largest mobile browser. Okay. So this was a slight detour around position. I hope you understand that a little better. Now let's talk about the meta viewport tag, because we have one job that we still have to do. In order to create a responsive design, we must set the layout viewport dimensions to the ideal layout viewport dimensions, right? Layout viewport tells the CSS how much space you have. The ideal layout viewport from the device tells you, okay, ideally the layout viewport should be this wide, because then it fits perfectly on our screen. How do you set the layout viewport to the ideal layout viewport dimensions? I'm kind of assuming some of you have already guessed the answer. That's where the viewport tag comes in. This tells the browser, dear browser, please take the layout viewport and resize it according to the ideal layout viewport. And all browsers do so, it all works, except for one tiny issue I'll get back to in a moment. Who here has used a meta viewport before? Yes. Now I hope you understand what it does and why. Not how, I mean, you already know that. You use a meta viewport, you use media queries, and it works fine. It does, but I want to explain why it works fine. So, we have the meta viewport. So, again, by default, the layout viewport is between 768 and 1024. Using the meta viewport tag sets the width of the layout viewport to a value of your choice, because most people use device width, and they are right to do so, but in theory, you can use a pixel value as well. For instance, width equals 400. Works perfectly fine in all browsers. How many of you knew this? Nobody? Wow, okay, so you can do this. Is it useful? Nah. But it's still, you know, a fun party thing. Say, oh, did you know that you can set the layout viewport to something else than the ideal layout viewport, and everybody will stare at you blankly, and they will buy you more beer so that you will shut up. It's a very useful trick. of course, most of the time, you use device width, which says, okay, take the ideal layout viewport. Let's talk about this a bit more. Because it turns out there is a second way of doing exactly the same. And I'm not sure if you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about this. Initial scale equals 1. This is a valid value for the meta viewport tag. And in theory, this means, okay, the initial zoom level of the site should be 1, and 1 means 100%. 100% of what? Turns out that it means 100% of the ideal layout viewport. I did not make this up. I'm not saying that this is a good idea or a bad idea. It is just how it is. And again, all browsers do so, including a few browsers you've never even heard of, but I tested nonetheless. In practice, in addition to setting the initial zoom level, it also sets the layout viewport dimensions to the ideal layout viewport, just as the width equals device width did. Why? I have no clue. But it works. If you take an initial scale of 2, that means, okay, please zoom in to 200% of the ideal layout viewport. And most browsers, not all, but most, also set the layout viewport to half the ideal layout viewport. Why half? Because zooming 200% means that the CSS pixels become larger, so fewer of them fit on the screen. So your viewport becomes smaller. This may be difficult to wrap your head around, but it really works this way. In practice, you never use this. Why would you? I have no clue. But you can if you really want to. And this is weird. And I don't know what Apple was thinking when they thought this up. But they did, and everybody else copied it. Okay. Now comes the fun part. The fun part of doing fundamental browser compatibility research is trying to mess up the browsers, trying to give them something that you think they will misunderstand, and then figuring out exactly how they will misunderstand, write a snarky blog post, and so on, and so on. So what I tried was this. What we're doing here is giving the browser conflicting orders. We first tell it to please set the layout viewport width to 400 pixels. And then we say, no. Set it to the ideal layout viewport instead, and also zoom it into 100%, because that's what the initial scale means. Doesn't matter. Basically, what does the browser do now when it gets conflicting orders? To my surprise, I thought that the browsers would be all over the place. To my surprise, they weren't. To my surprise, they did exactly the same, and that was taking the highest value. Even better, if you have a site in portrait mode, it takes the highest value of the two. If you then change it to landscape mode, it again calculates the highest value. So what we have here in practice is a minimum width layout viewport. This layout viewport will always be at least 400 pixels, possibly larger if the device says so. And again, if you change the device orientation, all this is recalculated. Is this useful? I have no clue. I don't think it is, because I've been giving this presentation for many years now and always ask the audience, as I'm going to ask you now, if you have ever used this, or if you know of a practical example where this would actually be useful, please come up to me and tell me after my presentation is done. So far, only one person in 4 years has reacted, and he had a very vague reply about something about background images, and the impression I got was that he was too lazy to resize his background images to a proper mobile scale. So he used this trick, and I thought, nah, that's not good enough. But in any case, you should be aware that this is possible. Again, don't make notes. I'll put these slides online. You can read it all. But in practice, I don't think this is very interesting. But you know, from a theoretical perspective, this is quite cool. I like this sort of stuff. That's why I do fundamental browser research. Okay, a slight Safari problem. If you do this in Safari, Safari always takes the portrait width of the initial layout viewport. On an old iPhone, it would be 320. If you switch it to landscape mode, it's still 320. While all other browsers recalculate it, right? because the screen is now wider, so more stuff fits on it, so the layout viewport should be become a little wider, and all kinds of media queries kicking, etc., etc. Now, back in the day, back 10 years ago, I understand why Apple did this. Because if you go from portrait to landscape and you change the layout viewport, that means that a whole page has to be re-layout. Right? They have to recalculate everything, and that 34% is now so many pixels, and so on, and so on. I can imagine that that was a bit much for the old iPhone hardware of 10 years ago. Right now, though, it should definitely work, but it still does not, as far as I know. Sometimes this is what you want. Sometimes it's actually useful, but at other times, it's not what you want. At other times, you want people who go to landscape mode to have a slightly expanded view of the site, right? Okay, so how do you solve this? Very simple. You use initial scale 1 instead. Now Safari does switch from portrait to landscape. Why? I have no clue. But it does. And all other browsers do the same, so you have no browser compatibility problems here. So my ideal viewport is still this one, because it clearly shows what we are doing. I use both device width and initial scale. Initial scale works in Safari, we saw that. And 4 years ago, I used to draw a laugh here because I told everybody, and device width has the same problem in IE10. But meanwhile, IE10 doesn't matter anymore. But still, you know, it was very funny back in the days. And both work in all other browsers. So I generally advise you to use this as a meta viewport. This will make sure that it works everywhere, including in Safari in landscape mode. Okay, so what we have done now is set the layout viewport, which constrains your CSS, to the ideal layout viewport, which is perfect for the device it runs on. So far, you have not actually figured out what that ideal layout viewport width is. You have no clue. You still don't know if you're on a huge Surface tablet or maybe on a tiny Samsung device. But you do not want to know for your CSS layout. That's where media queries come in, right? You already know this. This is a media query. Has anybody here never seen a media query before? Good. I don't have to explain that. There are two important media queries here. The first one is width, and the second one is device width, and width is the one you want. If you use device width for your media queries, I'm sorry to tell you that you are doing it wrong. Why is that? Device width gives you the width of the device. And on a desktop, that means the entire screen. But I don't care how wide the screen is, I care how wide the browser window is, right? And device width doesn't tell us that. On mobile, initially it might seem that device width is doing the right thing here, because it's clearly constrained to the mobile screen and not the entire layout viewport. Still, this is not what we want either, because it turns out that device width is dependent on the JavaScript property screen width. And screen width can have two meanings. First, the ideal layout viewport, which is what we want to know. But secondly, the number of device pixels. And it depends on the browser which definition screen.width uses. I'm going to get back to this later. But suffice it to say that if you use device width, it may horribly misfire on a few browsers. That's why instead you want to use width. Width just tells you, okay, how wide is the layout viewport right now? And on desktop, that's the same as a page. And on mobile, that's the same as the layout viewport. And that is the information you want, right? And then you can start to take CSS decisions. Oh, if the layout viewport width is smaller than 400 pixels, then I want to get rid of the third column. And if it's smaller than 300 pixels, then I want to get rid of the second column as well, and so on, and so on. So this is what you want to know, and you should always use the width media query in your CSS, because it tells you exactly what you need to know. So this is basically responsive design. I'm kind of assuming that you already knew that, but I hope that this part of the presentation explains to you why it is the case. It's always useful to know why something that you use a lot is working. So we set the layout viewport width to the ideal layout viewport width. And then we use the width media query to figure out, okay, but how wide is it now? And once we know that, we start to change our CSS. That's how responsive design works. One more thing about media queries. Always use min or max width. Never use width. Because if you say width 320 pixels, that means only if the ideal viewport is exactly 320 pixels wide, which is not enough. So you should always say, OK, if it's at least 400 pixels or at most 600 pixels, and so on, and so on. I'm kind of assuming you already knew that as well. There's one thing we haven't talked about yet, and that's JavaScript properties. Because so far we have talked about browser internals and about CSS, but it should also be possible to read out the dimensions of the viewports in JavaScript. And here we are starting to get into trouble. Not with the layout viewport dimensions. In all browsers, everywhere, the layout viewport dimensions are document, document element, client width, and client height. This is basically the JavaScript equivalent of a media query width. If for some reason you can't work in CSS and you have to figure it out in JavaScript, use this. This works. I think it works really everywhere nowadays. Yes, it does. So that's no problem. Then we have, by the way, I advise you to again look at the visualization app I created on your laptops. The layout viewport offset, which means how much has the layout viewport scrolled relative to the document, is this. Negative. Note the negative, it's very important. Document, document element, get bound and client. Oh, it should be client rectangle. I'm sorry, I made a mistake in my slide there. Stop this. Thank you. I'm sorry, I'm going to change this right away because otherwise I would give you wrong information. This is the proper syntax. Don't ask me why, I'm not going to go into it, but it works, but it's fairly unimportant information. You will rarely need this stuff. Except, of course, when you're working with fixed layers on a mobile device. Then it can suddenly become quite important. Okay, then we come to the problem child, the visual viewport. Window in a width, window in a height, but it doesn't work in a bunch of old browsers, which is not entirely surprising. But worse, it doesn't work in the most modern Chromes, because Google did a thing. Once again, I'll get back to the thing. The visual viewport offset relative to the document is window.page X and Y offset. Again, you can find all this in the app, so you don't have to write it down. And then you can actually see what I mean. This works everywhere, except in Chrome 61 and up, because Google did a thing. If for some silly reason you want to know the offset of the visual viewport relative to the layout viewport, there is no property available, but you can calculate it, because you've got enough data. So if you really want to know it, you can. I'm not sure why you would want to know it, but you can. Oh yeah, here is a screenshot. This is basically what you're seeing. In window in width and in the height gives this. Then documents, elements, client width and height gives this. This is the get bounding client rectangle. And this is page XY offset. Oh yeah, and also window.scroll XY if you need another property pair, which you don't. Just so you know. It's all available, but in general, you do not need this a lot, except when you do need it, and then you need it badly. But just know that they're available, and look it up when you need it. Still, this is pretty confusing, right? All these property pairs seem to have nothing to do with one another. Right? And that is, in fact, correct. They do have nothing to do with one another. What happens was that 10 years ago, when the whole concept of layout and visual viewport were invented, they needed some JavaScript properties to store the dimensions in, right? They wanted to expose it to JavaScript. Now, it happened to be the case that back in the browser war days, and I'm now talking about 20 years back, Netscape and IE both had their own property pair for the layout viewport. I think Netscape had window.inner-width, and IE had document-document-element-client-width. Could also be the other way around. Doesn't matter. In the case, there were two property pairs. So very cleverly, Apple, Nokia, and BlackBerry thought, OK, we're going to use one for the one and the other for the other, which makes total sense. And remember, W3C never specified any of this. There is no official standard. So that's why it seems to be all over the place, and there is no logic to it. Well, there is, but you have to know the history. I'm going to repeat this. W3C has still not specified any of this, which is pretty annoying. I mean, I explained how this system worked about 7 years ago, but they're not listening. Google, however, is doing something. And the problem is that half of what they're doing is an excellent idea, and I totally support it. The other half is terrible, but they did both anyway. What they said in Chrome 61 and up, we just need a new API for the visual viewport, right? Visual viewport width and height gives a width and a height, page left, offset relative to the document, offset left, offset top relative to the layout viewport, and scale. Scale is an Apple word for zoom. Zoom level relative to the layout viewport. This is all the information you need to know. We put it in one property of the window. Brilliant idea. I totally support it. This makes sense. The thing that they did after did not make sense, because they said all properties, the properties I explained just now, should be about layout viewport, which makes totally no sense because it breaks backward compatibility. If you use window.innerWidth because you know it's going to give you the width of the visual viewport, then suddenly changing that around is going to make a lot of problems for you. So page X and Y offset, in all browsers, it means the visual viewport offset, but in Chrome 61 Plus, it means the layout viewport offset. And window inner width height, the visual viewport dimensions, except in Chrome 61, where it's the layout viewport dimensions. This is crazy. It's even more crazier because there is a very simple and very efficient other way of doing that. But Google always wants to make things needlessly complicated. I don't know if you noticed it, but if Google has an idea, the idea is usually excellent, and then they start to actually work on the idea, and it grows and grows and becomes into something very complicated. You think, why are you making it all so complicated while it used to be so simple? This is one of these cases. The theoretical solution to this problem is extremely simple. I mean, it took me 30 seconds to find it, and it's this. We also create a window layout viewport. Makes sense, right? And we put the same properties there, except for this one, which we don't need. And maybe we don't need scale, I'm not sure. But we just have window visual viewport and window layout viewport with a bunch of properties. You can read out whatever you like. Makes sense, right? And because it makes sense, Google is not going to implement it, because they have very important reasons not to. I forget which ones. You can read it somewhere deep in a bug report somewhere on a very complicated Google site, whatever. So that's the situation we are in now, and I have no easy answer. Fortunately, well, I do have an easy answer, because if we go back here, you just detect visual viewport. If visual viewport exists, you take its width and height. If it does not exist, you take the old-fashioned window.innerWidth and window.innerHeight. Nonetheless, the problem here is that Google is just changing stuff for the sake of changing stuff. If they had just added this and left the rest of the system intact, brilliant, perfect solution. But no, they had to change stuff. So this is the theoretical solution that Google did not implement. And we're stuck with it now. And there's one thing I haven't talked about, and that's screen width and screen height. Screen width and screen height are terrible properties because you don't know what they mean. In some browsers, in most browsers, in fact, nowadays, they mean the dimensions of the ideal layout viewport, which could be interesting information in certain cases, right? But in other browsers, it just means the number of device pixels on the screen, which is completely useless information. Worse, you don't know which is going to be, and there is no way of detecting what the browser actually means. Believe me, I tried. Here's the compatibility as of about a year ago. This is all good. This is the dimensions of the ideal layout viewport, but a few older browsers do the physical device pixels on the screen. And note that Safari is stuck in portrait mode. Oh, excuse me. In Safari, like with device width in the meta viewport that we saw, screen.width is always the portrait width and never the landscape width. And get worse even, because screen.width is not reliable right now. And that means all those nice analytics scripts that you use, right, to figure out what kind of screen sizes are coming to your website, they're not reliable either because they all use screen.width. So if you see, I've once actually seen that in a log file of my client. They saw a certain Android device with a screen size of 1280, and then the same Android device with a screen size of 320. At least I knew it was the same Android device. They thought it was a completely different device. But I knew, no, it's two browsers on the same Android device. But the one does the screen width in one way and the other in the other way. Case in point. Check your log files. Do you ever see an iOS device in landscape mode? No, you don't, because screen width in iOS always gives back the portrait mode width and never the landscape mode width. So mysteriously, nobody ever serves your site on an iOS device in landscape mode. Look it up in your logs. You will see that I'm right. So don't trust all those screen size stuff that you see online. It is most likely incorrect. Besides, if you ask for the screen size of a device, what do you actually want to know? I'm not sure either. I mean, do you really want to know how many device pixels it has? I don't think so. Do you want to know its ideal viewport width? Well, maybe that is the better option of the two, but I'm not totally sure. Besides, on a desktop, there is no concept of an ideal viewport. Well, there is, but it's extremely complicated. So what you're seeing here is that analytics scripts are offering some information because it's easy to get, not because it's necessarily either reliable or useful to you. So think about that. I'm hoping you're not feeling too depressed after this presentation, because you know I ended with a bunch of stuff that did not work. But please don't forget that I started with a bunch of important stuff that does work. Responsive design actually works, right? The whole ideal layout viewport thing and the meta viewport and the media query width, they actually do work in all browsers. And yes, I tested them in all browsers and they work. But, you know, having a minor depression is quite common for a web developer, right? Especially when you have to deal with browsers. So if you are slightly depressed when exiting this presentation, you are a true web developer. And you'll survive. And remember, responsive design does work. Thank you so much. I will put these slides online. And that was the end of my presentation.